We don't generally talk about IPOs very often here at the Damage Report, but perhaps we should, because a recent report breaking down some of the factors that have gone into what sort of people are launching them and who is not is actually pretty fascinating. And joining us now to break it down is the editor-in-chief of Business Insider, Alyson Shontell. Welcome to the Damage Report.
Thanks for having me.
Glad to have you here. So what's lacking from this this group of recently launched IPOs?
Yeah, women, lots and lots of women. So over 400 companies went public in the US last year, and only about 4 were founded and led by women. And so, you know, that's a pretty steep contrast. And historically, it's not much better. When we pulled data with NASDAQ to look at how many examples we could find of female founders who were able to scale their companies to IPO and kind of maintain CEO as they were going public, that number we could come up with was only about 20. So that's 20 out of thousands of companies that are publicly traded on the stock exchanges. So there's a pretty wide gap between how big a woman can tend to scale their business versus a man.
That's pretty amazing. That historic number almost makes the number for this last year seem not as bad by comparison, but still obviously horrific if you're talking about 1%. So I know some of this is probably going to go into the area of speculation, but what are some initial potential hypotheses as to why this is?
Yeah, so you know, it's funny you say that about last year. Last year was like exponential growth, I guess you could say, in the chart. Before it was 1 or 2, and actually about 13 of the 20 examples we could find were in the last 7 to 8 years. So I guess things are improving, although we would like to see it improve quite a bit more. So some of the reasons, I think one that is widely discussed is what's going on in venture capital, the fact that there are, you know, of course, more men than women in venture capital seats of power with more capital behind them. That's part of it. And I think if you get more diversity within venture capital, then you could get more diversity around ideas and which ideas are worth backing. Of like the trillions of dollars that are spent in venture capital every year, only about 3%, less than 3% goes to all women founded teams. If you throw a man co-founder in the mix, like a woman and a man, then it increases to about 14%. And then like you don't even want to know for BIPOC women how bad it is, it's less than 1%. So BIPOC women aren't even giving like a single percentage of venture capital dollars. So that's a huge issue. And there's a lot of other reasons you could say, like I think that maybe because part of it's hard to get funding, harder to get funding if you're a woman. Women themselves are pushed to think of ideas that they uniquely can solve rather than solving the biggest problems in the world. And so the ideas probably aren't as big. So you're not, you know, Jeff Bezos wasn't uniquely qualified to start a bookstore online. He just did it, thought it was a huge sector that he should be going after. Elon Musk had no qualification to start, you know, rocket companies or anything like that. But he wanted to tackle giant ideas. And I think we also need more women to just feel more comfortable pursuing these giant, huge ideas that maybe they're not uniquely qualified for, but they want to tackle it anyways.
It also seems like if in venture capital you have so few women represented there, and women are being pushed into working on ideas or solutions or products that are specifically geared towards women, they also might not seem as appealing to a group of investors that don't necessarily know or value that world.
Yep, I think there's definitely a cyclical problem here to some extent.
Now you also mentioned, so part of the problem is the funding. You also mentioned and maintaining CEO after receiving the funding. Is that something that we've seen, that women are sort of being pushed out of leadership roles once that has been passed?
Well, so there's a couple things. One is when we looked at women who were CEOs of companies that they didn't found who were taking companies public, we only found about 9 examples of that. So there's not, even when you're looking at CEO positions of women, whether they founded the company or not, there's not that many examples, at least that are publicly traded currently. I think that if you look at corporate America, about 7% of all Fortune 500 CEOs are women. And often there are studies that show women get kind of put in sometimes a COO position or the number 2 position, but it's really hard for them to get to that number 1 position. And it's a little bit yet to be seen if the current ranking class of women who are like the Sheryl Sandbergs, who are, you know, COOs and could probably easily be CEOs in their own right, do make it onto that next step of becoming CEO. Like, will they become the Mark Zuckerberg? I think that's another thing that we hope to see a shift in. But right now, a lot of women are getting stuck in number 2s.
Mm-hmm. So we talked a little bit about some of the consequences that could come from more women being represented in venture capital, other than I guess some of the obvious equality benefits to more women receiving funding and leading IPOs. What are some of the other either economic or social consequences that you could see coming from that change?
Yeah, I think that there's a lot. It's not just some moral obligation that women and men should be equal. I think it's actually, Melinda Gates wrote a good book on this called The Moment of Lift. And she, out of all of her research and all of the work she's done, she found that if you just like lift up women in society, it actually lifts up the rest of society around it, creates more economic opportunity and whatnot. So, and there's a lot of studies that also show that companies can run more effectively often when women are in charge, not to say that men are bad leaders, they're often tremendous. But women, for whatever reason, you can see lifts in bottom lines based on different studies, all sorts of kind of economic game just within companies themselves when you have more women in power. So there's just good business reasons to do this. It's not just some moral stance, although I agree with that as well.
So look, obviously the numbers in terms of the IPOs, we talked about that they're going up, but they only seem to be going up so much because the basement was so low on that. Does it seem like there is movement in this direction? Are there initiatives that are being worked on that seem to be working to provide more diversity?
I think there's definitely more attention going into it. Like I think, you know, first I was talking to one other female founder, and she was saying like, look, first we needed to fill the stadium. We need to get more women in the arena, and we spent, you know, the last decade really trying to advocate for that. And there's more advocating we can do. But like now that they're in the arena, then we need to get them to like bigger and bigger positions and more capital behind them and things like that. So I think that's the phase of growth that we're in now. One is continuing to encourage women that, you know, entrepreneurship should be a path that more people should consider, especially when you look at, if you want really women to be as powerful as men, look at the most powerful people in the world. One good example of this is the billionaires list that Forbes does every year. All of them are men, or like, and they're men founders specifically, or they were inherited wealth from their dads who were founders or their grandpas who were founders. And so there's this, if you want to reach the same scale of power that men have, you need to build equal wealth if you're a woman. And the only way to do that is to create the next Fortune 500 companies. And so encouraging more women to consider that route earlier, I think is also important too.
Sort of getting that ambition going at an earlier age, basically.
Yes.
Okay. Well, Alyson, really appreciate you joining us on the show today and breaking down this report. Very fascinating, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, John.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.